Today we're going to look at the molecular basis of inheritance. A few lectures ago, we saw the idea of Jean-Baptiste LaMarck, who proposed a specific mechanism of evolutionary change. He outlined the idea that through use and disuse, physical structures change over an individual's lifetime. We saw that can happen. You can pump iron and get muscles. But then he said, these acquired characters are passed on to descendants. Lamarck is most famous for proposing the inheritance of acquired characters, and this we know is wrong. Darwin and Wallace, on the other hand, correctly proposed that pre-existing traits are passed on to their descendants. But what exactly is passed on? What is the stuff of inheritance? Today is the first of a series of lectures on genetics. Today we're going to look at the molecular basis of inheritance. Then we'll look at the pattern of genetic inheritance, both during cell division, reproduction, and then within families. And finally, we'll look at how genes are distributed, change within populations. The molecule of inheritance is deoxyribonucleic acid, mostly known through its initials, DNA. It's a double-stranded molecule of very interesting and precise chemical characteristics. So DNA is composed of a sequence of nucleotides, and each individual nucleotide consists of a phosphate, a sugar, and a nitrogenous base. These nitrogenous bases are the key parts of the molecule. These are the things that we're going to keep track of. Every nucleotide has the same phosphate, it has the same sugar. What's important is that there's variation along the length of the DNA molecule in the nitrogenous bases. So there are two kinds of nitrogenous bases. They're the purines and the pyrimidines. And in the purines, there are two compounds, adenine and guanine. And the pyrimidines, it's cytosine and thymine. Now, henceforth, I don't really expect anybody to remember purine, pyrimidines, and these whole names. But what you will want to know is A, G, C, T. We're going to follow this through their initials because that's how we kind of catalog the variation within a species. A, G, C, and T. So when we have a strand of DNA, that's a series of these nucleotides that are held together by the bonding of the phosphate with the sugar. So a nucleotide connects to an adjacent nucleotide with a chemical reaction so that this phosphate gives off a molecule of water. And so you have a sequence of bases going along the strand. So we have the phosphate sugar backbone. It's just there. It's a physical structure that's important for the integrity of the molecule. But we don't really care about any variation because there isn't any. What matters is that these nitrogenous bases can appear in any order along the same strand. So here we could have either A, T, C, or G. And adjacent to it could also be A, T, C, or G. These can happen in any order. Now, we have a chain of nucleotides here. Here's the sugar phosphate backbone, and here's a sequence of G, T, G, A, C, A, etc., etc. And there is a complementary partner on the opposite side. This is the double-stranded molecule. So the double-stranded DNA is linked by weak bonds between these complementary bases. So we have adenine on one strand attached to the sugar and the phosphate. We have thymine on the opposite strand also attached to the sugar and phosphate. And adenine pairs with thymine, or guanine pairs with cytosine. So as we go along on this, we find that A only links with T, and G only links with C. So in this example down here, on this strand, it's G, T, G, A, C, and the complementary partner is C with G, A with T, C with G again, T with A, G with C, T with A. Always those complementary partners. Now, if we look at the physical structure of a long strand of DNA in our body, we have this double-stranded helix, and they're kind of wound around various other bits and bobs in the cell. These are proteins called histones that just allow for a convenient packing, so everything is kind of wound tightly up in these clusters. And if you look at it from a larger scale out, then you have this wound up segment, and these are wound up too, and you look at it at a higher level with a less precise microscope and you see a chromosome. So the chromosome is like a whole long strand of yarn, all tightly wound in various ways, okay? And so then this is a very, very long strand, even though under a microscope, this may look really pretty tiny. Now, if we have at the finer resolution, so we can actually see the DNA strand in the chromosome, here it is, it's all wound around and packed tightly in on itself, okay? So if in the human chromosome, the DNA could be stretched out physically, it would be 6 feet long. So there's an enormous amount of information all going along, G-A-C-T-A, and I'll often refer to that as Gattaca, 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 because it can be any sequence of G-C-A-T-A, and it goes on for literally billions of base pairs in our body. So the first thing we want to know about DNA that's really key is this is a self-replicating molecule. So the first process that we want to know about with DNA is called replication, and that's the formation of two identical double-stranded DNA molecules from one pre-existing copy. So here we have our strand of DNA, it's unpacked a bit as compared to that last photograph, and we go along down here, and here we see that there's a separation. And what's happening is on either side, those complementary partners are being restored. So eventually we'll have two complete strands, complementary strands, of the DNA. So what happens is that there are a series of enzymes in the cell that go along the DNA molecule. These are called helicases. Again, I don't expect you to know these names, just that there are enzymes that do this sort of thing. And so the helicases separate this, and on one side we have an enzyme called DNA polymerase, which reassembles a sequence of nucleotides according to the complementary partners here. On the opposite side, there are similar enzymes and some that will fill in gaps if this is being done in multiple places. So all these different enzymes are working feverishly to ensure that we have one original double-stranded molecule, and after replication, we'll have two double-stranded molecules that are genetically identical to each other. So here's what happens in replication. We have our double-stranded molecule. Here's the sugar phosphate backbone. Here are the bases along here, Gattaca, 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 the complementary partners on the other side. First they get separated. Then the enzymes deliver single nucleotides, attach them to the growing chain with the pairing rule so that C comes in to partner G and A comes into partner T. Okay, on the other strand, because this is happening on both sides at once, a G is being brought in to partner with C and a T is being brought in to partner with T. So as we look down here, we see these are all identical on either side. So each strand forms the template for a complementary strand that perfectly matches the original partner. Now, this replication process happens within our cells very quickly. So Escherichia coli, which is a little bacteria that lives in our guts, its entire genome, or all the DNA in its chromosome, is 5 million base pairs long. And that whole thing can be replicated in less than an hour. Our genome consists of 6 billion base pairs, and this can be completely copied and replicated within 2 hours. So as this goes along, there are not only these enzymes that are making sure to bring in the right nucleotides, but they make a good effort at proofreading and repairing any mistakes in the resultant DNA molecules. So the first is called mismatch repair, where an enzyme proofreads the DNA and fixes mistakes, so that if there's been an attempt by the other enzymes to deliver a G with T, it says, no, can't do that. an A of a C, no, you can't do that. So it has to remove the wrong nucleotide and bring back the right one. And there's also what's called excision repair. So if there's sequences along the DNA that have been damaged, kind of like in a really bad DVD or something electronically that we think of with our computers, this actually identifies a bad sector, as it was, removes and replaces those damaged segments of DNA. So we've seen that complementarity of the nitrogenous bases allows self-replication of DNA. And there are numerous enzymes that assist the DNA during replication.